Hey guys, welcome to the Retro Army Podcast. We're back again. It's after WrestleMania 32. We're gonna talk about how much we might have liked it, might not. Don't know yet. You're gonna have to listen to this.
Eyes and lows, yeah.
Stephen Hensley, always back. Of course, Mr. Kevin Morse.
The always, the constant of the show.
So I guess when we get back, we're going to be talking about WrestleMania 32.
Fun stuff, huh?
The big 3-2.
Yay. So, stick around, guys. Hey! Alright, so let's go to...
I feel like Kevin Owens is, like, standing behind us here to be like, morons. Your stupid fucking internet show. Dumb fucking facial hair. You're almost kind of a beard over there. There's no hair on top. It's real cute.
Yeah. So this was...
Thanks for having me on.
This was the 7-man Intercontinental Championship ladder match. And the second the fans knew this match was coming, the arena went crazy.
They really did. And it was a good match. Yeah. Not so much in terms of psychology, but man, oh man, if you're into a highlight reel, this match is made for a highlight reel. And it delivered a cataclysmically positive moment.
Oh yeah, I mean there were just moments in there that were just amazing.
Yeah,
like the one for me was definitely Kevin. Just seeing Kevin Owens laying in that ladder,
folded up after that,
not moving, totally.
After Sami Zayn just tossed him to his death into the ladder, it was like the least like height involved of any spot, and I was convinced that he was like actually injured as soon as it happened.
Yeah.
I remember I looked at Facebook the next day, and there's a meme of like Sami Zayn looking over at Kevin Owens,
yeah.
And then there's the baby Simba cub from Lion King just like...
I saw that meme. I love that meme. We'll post that meme on here.
Can we please? We'll put it in the credits.
I mean, there were some things in that match. I was just... Stardust being folded up in the ladder.
I love Stardust. I wish he could get his due on a big stage. I feel like he's been doing some of the best work of his career at Stardust.
And then you have Miz up there showboating, gets pushed off, and then...
You know, and really, there were so many points in that, you thought so many people were going to, like, win that.
Yeah, exactly.
You thought Sammy was really going to have it.
I thought Sammy was
going to have
that.
And then I was sold that Miz had. I was like, oh, Miz is getting it. He's soaking in the moment. He's soaking in. Then it happens.
Yep, then it happens. The payoff right there.
The big
As
payoff.
You said last time, the payoff.
Dolph Ziggler did good in this match, too.
Sin
Cara didn't die or get injured, so he's better than the Alpha prototype.
Yeah, see, Dolph would have been my pick for this match, but Zach, holy...
Woo, woo, woo!
The Snickers.
Woo, woo, woo!
It was just like, he gets that belt, and I was immediately like 10 years old.
And he got the Snickers fish.
Yeah, he got the Snickers
fish. You're right. I get that 10-year-old feeling. I was like, oh, this happened.
Yeah.
This happened.
I was like so happy for the dude. His dad comes in the ring with a cowboy hat on. He's like, no, I don't want that hat. It's like, this
dude,
is
it's really weird. I'm just like, no, I don't want the cowboy hat. He's like, Dad, you're embarrassing.
And then the next night at Raw.
I'm a big time wrestler, Dad.
The next night at Raw, you see when he's a kid holding Razor Ramones.
Oh, that was great.
And then all of a sudden, Razor, has his belt.
Yeah.
Just like, that's awesome. That's what the payoff means to me right there. Feeling like I'm 10 years old again.
The crowd on Raw, too, their reaction to him. I mean, he got the brief 24-hour run, but that's on there for him.
Yeah.
That was his moment at WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. And the crowd saying, woo, woo, woo,
yeah.
You deserve it. Woo, 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 woo,
you deserve it.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I love the post-WrestleMania crowd.
I love post-WrestleMania crowd. It's awesome. And that match right there to me was like, if this is how we're going to open WrestleMania, it has a shot of being a great Mania.
Yeah.
Because that was a great match.
It was.
Yeah, there's no psychology or nothing, but just the way it played out. And with that many guys in the match, that's tough to do anyways. But the way it played out was just like, thank you. Thank you for giving us this match right
now.
It was a fun match. It made me remember a lot of things I loved about Mania.
And like you said, like the end made me feel like 10 years old.
Yeah.
I was light as air because I really, it's hard to surprise wrestling fans now. And sometimes, even if we're not expecting someone to win, it almost becomes old hat. I hate to say that with someone like Ziggler, who's so great, but like anything short of a serious world title push or a serious main event scene push is kind of underwhelming from him at this point.
And the cool part about that was when KO set up the match on Raw, He was one of like the second tier players, you know, going to be in the match. Comes out Mania, just makes it right there. And you're just like, this is what I watched for. This is what Mania is all about. Having them guys show up and they're there on the big stage. They win. They do something amazing. That match for me was amazing. I love that match. And I know I can go back and probably watch it again and again and say this was a great match.
It really is. It was a fun match to watch.
Yeah.
I don't know where I'd rank it on all-time ladder matches, but the end of it, I put in my top five.
Probably. Oh, yeah, easy. And it was just such a fun match. So I would say that one's a great match. It is. You can watch that match again and again.
You absolutely can.
All right, so next, we had the match I was kind of feeling lukewarm about, definitely.
What's that?
Jericho AJ Styles.
Okay.
And you were the one who's like, hey, this is going to probably be a really good match. And I'm like, you know, I just don't know how it's going to play out. It was a solidly great match. We got to see the Styles clash, which I marked out for, as always. I didn't really like the ending because I want AJ Styles to win, of course, but that's good. That means they're doing their job.
We got a lot of pieces of puzzles like in place. Mm-hmm. Like Jericho needed a big win for whatever they had planned for him next.
Yeah,
and the expectation was that would let the air of Styles balloon and that maybe the company wasn't that behind him. Of course, the next night, you got the number one contender match. You're getting kind of a Raw review in the middle of this, too.
Yeah, it's hard not to talk about Raw.
Because it really was an A to B thing. Like, you see where all the pieces were supposed to fall.
Yeah, and then they came out, fell in place the next night.
So, like, where's that leave Jericho going forward? What's the next thing for him?
See, I don't know, but it's definitely somewhere. It's going to be somewhere good. There's nobody lost in that match, if you ask me, because AJ Styles came out looking just as good. Jericho, you know, Jericho and him, they made each other look good.
Oh, yeah. I think Styles brought Jericho back to a point of relevancy. I don't want to say he hasn't been relevant. That short feud he had with Bray was certainly fun, and they had some good matches. But, I mean, he feels so much more relevant than he has in a long time. It's hard when you're just that. When the fans know you're just going to be here for a couple months and then you're gone.
Yeah.
Especially, like, that can go bad for some guys. Look at RVD 6 months
ago. Well, yeah, exactly. But the way that Jericho and AJ Styles worked that program.
Survived working the Fandango program.
So. But they're both set up for success now from the end of that, you know? You got AJ Styles, number one contender now. But Jericho could go
and whoever Jericho goes up against next, he's got that great shine from working with AJ.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's weird to say that Jericho got the shine from working with AJ, because AJ certainly got the shine from working with him, but he's got, that's a huge victory for him, because normally he doesn't get the big W at Mania anymore.
Yeah, and he got that big W against a guy who's probably going to be world champion in the next couple months. Mm-hmm. And it was just a solid match. We saw a lot of things that I didn't know if we were going to see him.
So much psychology, too.
So much psychology. They let us see everything. We had false finishes. I was so impressed with that match. And again, still feeling like a 10-year-old. And it might be because, you know, I've watched AJ Styles wrestle the Indies and Japan and all that. And now he's here. He's in the WWE. And I haven't watched the WWE for, you know, probably 9-10 years up until the last about 3 months I've been getting back into it. Because they've been bringing in all these guys from the Indies. They're revamping their whole programming. And it's like, thank you. Thank you. It's finally looking like it may come back and it may, you know, work. And for the Jericho and AJ Styles match, that is just, it's like a gateway drug now. It's like, I want
to
see
that's a feud that I think we're going to see them come back to over time. Jericho keeps with the recurrences, which I feel like he certainly will as long as they allow him to, as long as he's in the mood to do it.
Yeah, if he stays in shape, he's able to do it, because he is getting a little older now,
Talking about him like he's a lion in the winter.
Well, look at this. The Lionheart. Lions always go out fighting at the end. So this could be the end of Jericho. I have no idea. But I love that match. I would say that's 2 thumbs up, definitely. Yeah, it was a great match.
Oh, it was great. It was great. It may have been the best one-on-one male match on the show.
Oh, it hands down probably was. So right there, you got two matches that were, I would say, just awesome. They definitely lived up to the expectation of WrestleMania. Now we go to match 3, which, again, I felt like a 10-year-old kid again. Just for the entrance. Just for the entrance.
What?
New Day rocks.
What?
New Day rocks.
What?
New
T-Rock Videos!
Where's my trombone? Where's my trombone?
Where's the trombone? Where's the trombone? We need to dance.
Who would... Okay, they didn't come on unicorns like you said.
No, I was hoping.
But they came out of a
20... Can we get them unicorns, real live unicorns next year?
They came out of a 20-foot tall
box. Video box! Videos!
It's like, that is amazing!
They make sure you ain't booty. And I so, love the New Day.
And then you get the League of Nations, yep. Which now is one less member.
But Falling Raw, yep.
Yeah, Falling Raw. Yeah, again, Falling Raw.
Another spoiler.
One less member there.
Yeah.
But,
you gotta put up the spoiler alert now.
Yeah, we're at that
point. It's already happened. Yeah. No spoilers. All spoilers.
You should have had it on TV.
You should have had it. Should have watched. What kind of wrestling fan are you?
Yeah, what kind of wrestling fan are you if you're not watching?
Seriously, 3 weeks later.
That was a fun match to watch, though. It wasn't the best of matches. Mm-hmm. You know, it felt like it could have been a Raw, honestly. But it was a fun match to watch. The entrance
was I thought it was great. I thought it was solid. I questioned not making a tag title match.
Because
mm-hmm. That's what I thought it was originally booked as.
Yeah.
It was a tag title match.
See, I thought it was a tag title match.
I thought it would make more sense going to the next night when New Day even won.
Mm-hmm.
For the league to turn on Barrett Moore, would have made more sense if they would have just lost the titles.
Yeah, but still.
Having said that, I thought the match was a good match. I have no complaints about the quality of the match that they had. Mm-hmm. Would have liked to see New Day win, but I'm not hung up on it. It was a good...
It was a solid match. It
good
was a solid
tag team match.
Yeah, because it was a...
And I think it's weird, however... That a year where the tag division was so strong overall and they have so many working components going forward.
Yeah.
That they didn't actually have a tag title match at Mania.
No.
Do we need a tag team wrestling matters movement? Do we have to go to Twitter and just like crap all over them not giving like tag teams to do?
Yeah, but okay. Here's what kind of... I know a lot of people are probably going to give me some grief for this.
Uh-oh.
But the end of that match killed me.
I was wrong with the end of it.
All right, so you got League of Nations winning. And like you said, this could be the stepping stone where there's something bigger and better. And then you crush them with the Legends. You literally get Mick,
you know, HBK. I don't think that's crushing them. It could be crushing someone else. It is not crushing the New Day.
No, not the New Day. I'm not saying the New Day. I'm saying the League. The League.
I don't think that
you got
either.
Three guys that haven't wrestled in how long?
Yeah, the three most over guys in the history of time in wrestling that you can get in the ring on that day.
Yeah,
I mean, the only guy that gets to go over on top of those guys is The Rock.
Yeah, so you got they come down, beat down the League of Nations. Now, it could go either way there. It's like, oh, well, they're so awesome, we gotta send the best superstars from the past to beat them up.
Or it's just, that was all about working them onto the show. I did think it was kind of weird.
Mm-hmm.
The choice of people that have come out to do that too, but yeah. I think that was maybe more about getting the Legends in the ring to have a moment with New Day after,
mm-hmm.
So it kind of neutralized their loss more with the crowd, and they still got a really cool WrestleMania moment.
Well, yeah, they did
for them by their standards, because New Day's career, I don't want to say they're not great in the ring because they're incredible in the ring,
yeah.
But they were incredible in the ring for years.
Oh yeah, totally.
What's really gotten them over is their characters now,
mm-hmm.
Who they are. And that moment after the match almost meant as much as winning the match for them in terms of their career going forward. Mm-hmm. That's their moment. That's the kind of moments that their careers made.
Well, that feels like it was more of a push to New Day to have, you know, Mick, HBK, and Stone Cold come out there.
And Stunning Xavier Woods.
Yeah, Stunning Xavier Woods. You know, it almost felt like it was like, here's a good rub.
Here's a rub, kid.
Here's a rub. The last Stone Cold Stunner I may ever give right now. Boom!
Pass me a beer.
Yeah. And then you got Austin just like... You're like, Austin's dancing?
I love that Austin and Rock give no craps to be like as much as they were in the Attitude Era.
Yeah, I know.
Like, Rock will just go out there and say, dildo, titty, vagina, fuck. And be like, yep, too big a star. See you next week, kids. What are they going to do? Tell me to stay off Mania? You love The Rock.
you love me. Now, when those three guys came out, I was just, the first thing that popped in my mind is like, God, they are old now.
Yeah,
I transferred right out of that 10-year-old self at that point to like, reality hit me. It was just like, hey.
I wonder what it's like sometimes to, well, I'm going to veer off subject. But what's it like to be a child, like growing up with today's wrestling and the network?
See, that's an interesting question. We'll probably hear somebody's podcast.
If you have a thought on the matter, if you have a 10-year-old, ask them and post a comment below the video.
Yeah, right?
Prove to us that somebody out there will take the initiative to follow through.
Now, as for the match itself, I love the match. I thought it was a great match. It was a fun match to watch.
I'm going to give it a thumbs up for sure.
Thumbs up.
I'm going to give it 2.
You're going to give it 2? Yeah, I'll give it 2 just because I love New Day. They can't do no wrong in my
book. They can't.
They're going to be doing what The Rock did this year, coming out and having the fans
going crazy. My 10-year's problem.
Yeah. All right. This brings me to the match that I'm sad to talk about right now. Sorry, Dean.
All right, heads down.
Go.
You're still in the way.
Hell yeah.
Your chair is too tall.
Ah.
All right, we're good.
So we had Brock Lesnar defeated Dean Ambrose. This match was the one I thought it'd be like Dean would come out. He'd be all Johnny Moxie at this point. And it would be a fun match because he could literally beat the shit out of Brock and it'd be awesome. And then you get the suplex. Now, you said it'd be suplex.
I'm almost on point.
The match ran 14 minutes.
It did go longer than that.
And so we said 20 minutes. There were a ton of suplexes. You were pretty much on point with that. The fun part was watching Brock just grab kendo sticks and snap.
It was just weird. Did Brock look like he was starting to get fed up getting hit with a kendo stick?
He was. His back was getting welted up.
He's like, no. A little bit pissed.
Then Ambrose didn't even get to use the barbed wire baseball bat.
No, he pulled it out, missed. Mm-hmm. Brock hit him. Brock killed him.
Yeah, Brock murdered him. And then, now he did pull a Terry Funk and threw a ton of chairs in the ring, which was fun to watch. He took an F5 on him, okay, and a suplex.
It would be cool if you got to use about 10 of those chairs.
Yeah, but to me, that match, I wanted more. I wanted more. And it was just like, when Brock decided it was over, it was over.
I think my biggest problem with it is pulling out the barbed wire mat at all and not once connecting with it. It's such deflation in terms of a potential spot. I get Brock as beast. He can stop anything, but at the very least, have Brock bust Dean open and beat him mercilessly for the last 3 minutes.
Yeah.
If he's not going to get busted open with that bat, just have him do the F5. Have him have the match won and say, you know what, a little more.
A little more.
Just like drape the head of Dean, just like bust him open, then just knock him around for another 2 or 3 minutes. Same thing.
Yeah, it was underwhelming.
Yeah.
It wasn't what I wanted to watch at Mania.
I don't know why they didn't connect with that.
And it was like the start of the
decline. It's like setting a table on fire and walking away from the table.
Yeah, it was like the start of the decline of Mania for me. Because I already knew Mania was going to suck at the end.
What's next, dude? Do we need a break? Do you need a pee-pee break there, fans?
No, we don't need a break.
No break for you.
No break.
No break.
I don't know. It's just, this match just had so much underwhelming to me. And this is the one I was building up to. This was the match I wanted to see. I'm like, Dean Ambrose in a hardcore environment can match Brock Lesnar. Not at all.
It wasn't exactly what I was looking for. It wasn't bad. It wasn't great. It was... I want to say it was neutral. I want to say it was like almost a thumbs up, but I was really expecting 2 thumbs up.
Yeah, I was expecting so much more, and the buildup was so great going into
it. I think it's the last 3 minutes just needed more.
Yeah, they needed
3 more minutes.
And they could have been.
Somebody needed to bleed. At the very least, somebody needed to be bleeding buckets of blood.
Yeah, but I don't know. I was depressed.
It is what it is.
I was like, oh.
I'm sorry, buddy. I'll be all right, little Kev.
Yeah, at least I'll go to IWA Masters of Pain this year. Feel redeemed.
Oh, yeah.
Last year was awesome. Are you going this year?
What is?
I'm not sure, but it's up in Charleston. You can ride
with me. We should go.
We will go.
We will go.
All right, so I'm going to say, honestly, for me, personally, I'm giving a thumbs down.
Really?
I am. It was everything I know Brock Lesnar can do. It's nothing I know Dean Ambrose can do.
Yeah, but that's Brock Lesnar's matches.
I just felt underwhelmed by it. I just felt like it was almost a squash match at a point.
It's almost a squash match. I thought Dean looked better overall than I thought he was going to get to look.
See,
I think your expectations for what Dean was going to get to do in this match way beyond what you should have expected of the man that absolutely killed John Cena at SummerSlam.
Yeah, but we'll talk more on that. We'll talk more on John Cena in a few minutes. All right, so I'm going to say it was a thumbs down for me. I just didn't care for
it. All right, it is what it is.
What about you? What was it?
It was an almost.
Almost a thumbs up.
Not really glowing praise, I'll give you that.
All right, so moving forward, we had this match.
Oh, this duck down. Sasha's so pretty. All those ladies are hot.
I'm more about a Becky Lynch fan myself.
Yeah.
That match was good. That was I'm going to be honest, that's probably one of my top three all-time favorite women's matches.
Oh, yeah, dude, it was great. And I firmly feel it was the best match at WrestleMania this year.
Do you really?
Yeah.
It was a solid match.
It absolutely was. It had more psychology than the ladder match. Mm-hmm. It had better overall wrestling than any other match on the show, really.
They were super technical. They didn't blow their spots. Everything went right in that match. Other than the Nate helping out the win, but that still was brilliant.
Still perfect.
Because that's what Nate does now.
That's what managers used to do.
Yeah, it was very old school match. It was a fun match to watch. You're right, it was sound. Everything was sound about
it. And the crowd was super into it. I think that's the most relevant point. I almost, especially after watching the main event that we'll get to later, I feel like this match maybe should have been the show closer.
Mm-hmm.
Having said that, I mean, I think this is an easy one. This is...
Oh, yeah, it's thumbs up, definitely. And another thing I love about this is they retired, as someone I know says, the tramp stamp title.
That's how he called it that?
Yes.
It is kind of a tramp stamp, isn't it?
Mm-hmm,
I can absolutely see, like, some, like, chick from the trailer park.
I mean, look at the belt. Look at the belt.
I feel like someone from the trailer park could get that, like, tattooed on their lower back.
The little butterfly.
Like, some overly serious wrestling fan shit.
That's like
I'm a diva.
It's nice to see the tramp stamp title gone and the women's championship.
And it's a cool looking title too.
Oh,
the women's championship.
It's not. It's like this nice mix of the Intercontinental belt and the World Heavyweight belt.
I really feel like they missed an opportunity not putting this match on. It's the last match, the main event match. Because the introduction of that title, along with everything else that they seemed to put into the women's match all weekend, I felt like they were pushing that better than they were pushing the main event match.
Oh, yeah.
And I feel like the fans were responding to it better than the main event match. And I feel like if they would put that on last, I feel like the fans still would have been happy. I think the end of the show would have been more electric overall when you look back on this 10 years down the line.
Yeah.
And I think the amount of mainstream attention they get for putting a women's match on in the main event a year after they received so much criticism, the PC love they would get would have been astronomical.
Exactly. And one thing the women's title does is really give something like, you know, my daughter's 2.5.
Mm-hmm.
Now, she's watching wrestling. This gives her somebody to look up to. Mm-hmm. It's not the Divas title. Because that's like saying...
Has she discovered Bayley yet?
No. That's like all the Disney princesses. It's like packaged bullshit, honestly. That's what the Divas title was to me. Packaged bullshit. Now, the women's championship just has that allure that just feels like... Mm-hmm. This means something again.
Oh, yeah.
It's like they're finally given... The Intercontinental Championship has relevance again.
Mm-hmm.
The Women's Championship has relevance. These belts were just like push-me-offs, like cast-overs in the past.
I firmly believe over the next half a decade, we will eventually see a women's tag team title return.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's so many women that they're going to want to pair together to work together as allies.
Yeah.
Makes no sense to have an ally in a division that doesn't have an alternate championship for your ally to chase.
And you're right, this was a better bet.
Also, Charlotte needs a stable eventually. She needs to have a reason to have people watching her back beyond I'm genetically superior, please be myself.
The new Four Horsemen, you know, she's hinted at that before. But I mean, this...
could be awesome.
You're right, this could have been the main event, and it would have been a hell of a lot better than the shit we got shoveled down our throats. And yes, I'm being very brutal against that main event for very good reason, because it was probably one of the worst main events I've ever seen in Mania history. I would put it up there with Hogan Sid, but we'll get to that. We'll get to that.
It's Hogan Sid bad?
That's Hogan Sid bad, but we'll get there. Just saying.
I forgot how much that pissed me off. I loved, like, everybody involved in the components of that, but man, what a shit finish that was.
Right? All right, then we had the surprise match. I might be out of order on this. I don't really know where this match fell. There's your John Cena clip, by the way.
Hey, what do you say, boys?
The Rock defeated Eric Rollins.
Oh, yeah, six seconds.
6 seconds.
WrestleMania record.
He comes out, talks about it. Attendance record.
You mean Mundy?
Yeah. He comes out, talks about attendance
record.
Yep, yep. But I'm saying he comes out, talks about attendance record. Here comes Bray Wyatt, and you're like, oh, well, at least he got on Mania somehow.
Yeah.
And then he
held his own on the mic with The Rock, too. And the fans kept with him, which is harder to accomplish against The Rock.
He has, like, this hypnotizing type of charisma.
Do you think that part of it, though, at this point, is the fact that they haven't given him the carry yet, that people are just lusting so much for it that he can almost do no wrong? And do they realize that, and is that maybe, like, while everyone's wondering why, is that part of the reason why he hasn't gotten that cure? Because we're just getting hungrier and hungrier waiting.
Yeah, I want to see him do more. I know he's capable of more. And just look at the damn arena when he's walking out.
Oh, God, yeah.
There's just little flashlight phones everywhere, and it's like...
It's cool!
And I totally had forgot about him until that moment at Mania, and I'm like... Why the fuck's he not wrestling? Where's he on the card? Ryback got a fucking match, but Bray Wyatt did it.
I think Bray's been injured. He's had a back injury of some kind. So, yeah.
But he can talk.
He can, which is why he comes out all the time and then he feeds his minions to the wolves.
And then here comes freaking...
But he's still out there. No one's forgot about him, so...
And here comes The Rock, rips off his stuff in full, you know, battle-ready gear of The Rock. And you're
with
like...
With a flaming rock sign?
You're like, thank God, he came out of a flamethrower and he's ready to wrestle. Maybe he can help save it. 6 seconds later, you're like, well, at least he set a new record.
Yep.
And then it's like, okay, they're going to jump him, and all of a sudden you hear, dee-dee-dee-dee. You're like, ah, fuck, John Cena. And then I'm just kind of, honestly, at this point, I'm like marking out for Cena because the Latin, you know, I was still kind of depressed about the Ambrose Brock Lesnar match. I'm like, thank God John Cena's out here.
Now, mid-card John Cena really won me over this last year, though. Mm-hmm. Like, it got to the point I was looking forward to watching his U.S. title open challenge every week so much more than almost everything else on the show. And at the same time was when I started really loving New Day. I remember getting on Facebook one time. I was like, the hell is going on with wrestling? All of a sudden, I'm looking forward to John Cena's matches the most, and the New Day are my favorite thing in wrestling.
Yeah, John Cena was killing me for a while, especially with, like, the middle rope stunner. He was missing, like, 90% of the time.
Yeah, but when he hit it, it looked cool as hell.
It looked cool as hell, but...
Stone Cold had the best point about that. Why in the hell would you debut a new move as awesome as that and not make it your fucking finish?
Yeah.
Like, why are you just going to pull that out in the middle of the match, get a response like that, and then not pin the son of a bitch? You're not going to add a new tool to your repertoire?
That's so funny, and that's true. But, yeah, so I kind of marked out for Cena just because he was back. Mm-hmm. It's like, thank God, maybe things will get interesting, because he can make things interesting.
He should feud with Kalisto over the U.S. title and be a super heel.
I would love to see him break out of that PG mold.
America.
I know he'll never break out of that, you know, because he's like the reincarnation.
I don't feel like that's impossible. I think we're on the wind down of John's career. I think now it's less important for him to be that guy.
But he is I feel like he is.
But do you remember how much more money Hogan pumped in the industry when he finally let go after that long?
Oh, yeah.
When it was finally so still that it was just time to flip it.
And here comes the NWO.
Think about it. John, 2-3 years winding down, really at the end, really less important. You need something really, really fresh to generate the next new group of baby faces.
Yeah.
Super heel Cena with a stable. I mean, really, how about Cena and Roman go heel at the same time, and they're just the corporate guys?
That would be funny as hell.
Just like totally unapologetic, totally beating everyone up. Kane and Big Show, their lackeys. Everything that the wrestling mark community hates, like in one thing, just saying F you to all the fans. Just being the lords of wrestling like they've been for the last decade, 2 decades, whatever.
Yeah, it would be fun. And, you know, one thing I thought was really cool is Five Knuckle Shuffle is definitely a play on the people's elbow.
God, yeah.
And getting to watch both of those within the same minute almost was just like super fun for me. Because I'm like, oh, so The Rock doesn't really care about that. And they're both like, yeah, whatever. And at the same time, you got The Rock looking back like, you just stole my moment, you son of a bitch.
Fruity Pebbles eating son of a bitch.
Maybe next year at Mania they'll wrestle, which would be kind of cool.
Who, Cena and Rock?
Cena and Rock. I would like that. Because Rock was supposed to originally have Rosie with him. And, well, where's Rosie is what I call her. It's wrong.
Oh, okay. I was like, Rosie O'Donnell? I'm like, no, man, we've got the kibosh in there in 10 seconds.
I call Ronda Rosie. And everybody's asking me why, and I'm like, I don't know. The first time I ever saw her name, I like glance over real quick. I'm like, oh, Rosie's a UFC fighter, whatever. And they're like, no, it's Ronda. And I'm like, ah, fuck, it's Rosie now.
Didn't see misogyny is alive and well.
Yeah, yeah. Isn't important. Yeah, but whatever. So that happened. And then you get to that picture after Flamethrower Rock.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You can't see me. Speaking of which, if I pull this down. Oh, wait. There it is. Disappearing. Where'd I go?
Apparently, wait, move over a little. I think John Cena's head will be yours.
Over there?
Wait. There you go. Oh, no, you're covering his head. Oh,
son of a bitch. It was worth a shot.
It was worth a shot. All right, dude. We're trying.
We're trying.
So many clips.
So, oh. Here comes the money. Dollar.
Now, this match was weird.
So weird.
It was so fucking weird.
All the credit in the world for these guys to do everything short of killing each other to get it the fuck over, though.
Yeah.
It definitely delivered on every expectation I had for this match.
It did, me too, but the beginning was so slow and weird. It's like they're in the cell and it's just kind of rolling along at, like, not even methodical pace, just like slower than methodical, and I don't even know if that's possible. And it's like, oh my goodness, this is kind of dragging on now. And then he grabs these bolt cutters, cuts the, you know, the panel off, and I'm like, all right, shit just got real. And then the magic started happening. The second they stepped out of the fucking Hell in the Cell, it was like a glass box of just mediocre, and then they step outside into WrestleMania. And it's like, holy shit. The allure just, boom! And then just magic out there. And then Shane, you knew it was going to happen. You knew it was going to happen knowing this guy.
Yeah, but you know, when he climbed up top, I was like, you can climb back down. It's all right, brother. You don't have to do this.
We know, dude. We know you.
We get it, man. You got balls of steel.
And then all of a sudden, you just see, and you're like, oh, God, here he comes.
He looked very trepidatious before he did that. He's like, huh, perhaps I made a great mistake.
And he comes flying off it.
Boss of Steel.
And then he's just like,
no one's ever going to say he didn't earn his spot in the history of wrestling.
Well, my favorite part about him the whole time is just like,
begging for more of the Undertaker's like.
And then you see, like, at the end, when Undertaker has the tombstone at the end, like, almost just has to. He could have won the match. He probably could have just pinned him. But it's like, that's not how the Undertaker ends a match. He's like, come on. And he's just like, and then just picks him up with tombstones. I'm like, sorry about that.
Child.
Yeah. This is almost done. And then
I love,
like,
the little Shane O'Max running around with Shane. Oh, yeah. I feel like he was like, well, if I'm going to do the same, man, you got to let me bring the kids out.
Well, you know the company's in good hands with those kids anyways.
I don't think the company's going to be in those kids' hands.
I think it will
Shane's
eventually.
Very hands-off with the wrestling side of things. I think he's got several projects of his
own. Well, I know he has plenty of projects of his own, you know, but I'm just saying, those kids aren't going to be the future running that company.
I think it's going to be Hunter and Steph's kids, but you're right, they'll end up with jobs.
They'll all end up with jobs. It's like the mafia at this point, they just keep growing.
They're going to buy everything in the end.
I don't know, Vince lost, what was it, like $700 million in like one day a while back with the network.
Yeah, I mean, that's all initial investments.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes.
Plus, they've eclipsed their original estimates for where they thought it would be by this point.
Yeah.
And they got 36% growth increase after following WrestleMania.
I mean, you got to imagine, because none of the pay-per-views are on any cable or satellite providers now. It's all through the fucking network. So that's all money for them. and all these new subscribers and return subscribers. So Mania season's good for their profit.
Yeah.
Hell in a Cell was good for us to know that the people who could be running the company, if Shane does do something with the company, we love him. You know, he's not like Vince. Vince made himself a bad guy, though. People used to love Vince, too. But they still love him, even
Hell
on Raw.
They love Slash Hate.
Yeah, even on Raw, they were, you know, chanting for the product, chanting about what he did. And then Shane comes out and everybody goes ape shit. And what I think, you know, that match right there definitely showed that the McMahons do have a passion. It wasn't just Shane. It was the whole family of the passion for the business.
Oh, how about Taker's passion for the business, too?
Taker's always had passion for the business.
Yeah, but I mean, like, he's still that storyline point for the show. Long after his body is starting to go, you can see the slowing and the pain.
Well, that Brock Lesnar match was probably the worst point I've ever seen The Undertaker at.
Looking back on it, though, I think he was supposed to look that way no matter what because they had seen him do the same thing.
Well, he looked frail and just, you know, about to break almost. And he looks good. He looks a lot better than he did now. Mm-hmm. You know, he looks like The Undertaker again. Mm-hmm. He was like, I think he was mad skinnier like 2 Manias ago when he went against Brock. He looked sickly almost, and now he looks like The Taker again. And yeah, for me, that match, the Hell in a Cell match, was more of... The match for me wasn't what I was super expecting, but the symbolism of the match for me was just amazing. There was so much, you know, for that match that it could have went either way, really. And it really was just one of those matches that you just... Well, I thought the beginning was slow. I just really loved the ending of it and how much it showed that the Taker and Shane have a passion for the business. Because that's all it came down to at the end was a passion to be in the ring on the grandest stage of them all. And that's what I loved about it. So I loved that match. And if you go back and watch that match, I think you can just see it in their eyes. There's a special sparkle. You don't always see that in athletes. You know, but when you see those two just look at each other right before that tombstone, you could see it. And it was one of those really, I'm getting goosebumps talking about it now, just one of those moments, though, that's like, you don't see it happen ever. And that was fun. I loved it. So for me, that was 2 thumbs up.
Yeah, 2 thumbs up.
That was 2 thumbs up.
Good job done, gentlemen.
All right, now here we go.
Here we go.
Now, we both had predictions about the Andre the Giant Battle Royal.
Yeah.
The funny part is, you were a believer. Mm-hmm. He was the second to last guy eliminated.
Yeah.
I believed in Kane. He was the last guy eliminated.
I mean, we had the right two guys that we knew were in the Battle Royal.
Yeah, we got there.
But we didn't know they were sending an NXT guy out.
Yeah, right?
When Baron Corbin walked out, I immediately thought, well, my prediction's fucked.
You know, I kind of thought that too. I was like, and they pushed
especially
him.
Especially when I realized he's literally the only NXT guy in this match.
Mm-hmm.
This didn't happen by accident.
No. It's like, oh, he's here from NXT. You got DDP, diamond cutting people. You got...
Shaq?
Shaq?
What is Shaq doing in that match? I refuse to believe this happened, that Vince McMahon had a gigantic former sports icon on WrestleMania wrestling, and there was no promotion behind it.
because when Carl
this should have been like
in WCW, it was huge.
How about every time they've had a celebrity set foot on WWE programming?
Yeah,
I mean Jiminy Cricket, they had Federline beat Cena.
Yeah, I mean fuck, Donald Trump and Drew Carrier in the WWE Hall of Fame at this point. So you got Shaq. Nobody knew. Here comes Shaq, and you're just like. The fuck, and his entrance had me rolling. I saw the Shaq logo, and I immediately thought of because when I was younger, Shaq had these Kmart shoes. Mm-hmm. We always were like, these are the most Bobo shoes ever, and they had that logo. And I'm like, oh god, the Bobo logo's up, and here comes Shaq. And then everybody just starts beating on Shaq and freaking bitch.
That's what I did not realize is that Shaq is taller than all of those guys.
I know.
Holy crap, he was taller than Shaq.
Yeah, Kane looks up at him and just,
like,
I don't know what
the hell.
He's
literally the biggest guy out here.
Yeah. He's like, I was like, that's awesome. And then it totally ended unexpectedly.
Yeah.
And I was like, Hey, an NXT guy got a push.
I really thought the Outcasts were almost going to pull it off for a minute.
Yeah, they're running circles.
Oh, man, I love the victory lap.
They did the victory lap, and then they came up to, what was it, Kane?
Yeah, they backed out.
Whoops, wrong way.
Who was it they bumped into after that? Was it Show?
No, it was Show and Shaq were out first. I forgot.
Kane and some other big sub again. Was it Corbin?
Might have been Corbin.
I don't know, but I remember they like tried to split off. Like,
Oh, yeah. But having Corbin win that was awesome.
Yeah, it was a good
And they were just goal. Talking. They were talking him up the whole time, too. So that's how you show up at WrestleMania, is to win that battle royal. And it's like, okay, that's cool. It's like, he don't give a crap about no one. And I'm like, yeah, I like this guy. You know who else didn't give a crap about nobody? Vampiro. And that's who he reminds me of.
I love Vampiro.
I do too. I love Vampiro's
character. Vampiro's great.
Oh, I love
Still
watching
a great
Lucha.
Character. He's done such good things for Pentagon Jr. We could talk all day about Lucha Underground.
Yeah, we could.
That's another show.
But I don't know if that's where, you know, I don't think this was the second to last match. It may have been. I don't know.
Was it? I don't know. I think maybe it was, bro.
All right. And then we get to
It was the cool down match.
Yeah, you're right. It was. So then we get to this match, and this is the main event, and I am.
what do we have to say about this? Well, to be fair, first, let's talk about the things we liked about this match. Triple H's entrance was awesome.
Triple H's entrance was
so cool. And Steph was hotter than the fires of hell that night.
Steph looked like a fucking dominatrix ring match.
Oh, it was so hot. Awesome. It's so hot.
I love her in those outfits too. And
She's
like,
so good at playing the bitch too.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, well, this part's awesome. And then Roman Reigns' music hits and the audio instantly drops on my TV. And I'm like, what the fuck just happened? So I'm like hitting the volume. I didn't know what the fuck's going on.
Yeah, from the get-go.
And come to find out, they turned their own sound system down so you wouldn't hear all the boos for Roman Reigns. And I'm like, okay. First thing is, what the fuck, guys? Already are going to boo him.
We already know what's happening.
Yeah, we know what's happening. Everybody in that building knows what's happening. Because everybody's, you know, booing, thumbs down. The guy was flipping him off up top. When I would rewatch it, they blurred him out. You know?
Did they really?
Yeah, they did. Because I watched this match twice just to see if I could find some good in it.
I can't believe they blurred him out.
The second time I watched it, I fell asleep almost middle way through.
How would you like to be the guy that gets blurred out by the crowd?
On WrestleMania. It's like, that was me. You know, it wasn't. That guy's blurred out. We don't know who the fuck he is.
You weren't there.
It's just like the little guy. He's like this, you know. Well, my TV's like that. Y'all can't see it. Yeah. Anyways, yeah, he got blurred out, and I'm like, that's a bitch move right there too.
Yeah.
You turn the sound down. You're blurring people out.
But the match itself,
it did not work.
It's weird because we were talking about. I expected it to be a good match in spite of the fan reaction because last year's main event was amazing.
I expected it to suck. And it did not disappoint.
No, it did disappoint.
Well, it did disappoint what I expected.
No, it disappointed you. It just actualized your perception.
Yeah. it was validation for
you. You're validated.
Yes. Because it came... Roman Reigns... Okay. Somebody on Twitter posted that, you know, Triple H is very slow and methodical in his approach. Mm-hmm. And then Roman Reigns just sucks. So they don't work together well. If you put sucks with Triple H, Triple H generally has some decent matches.
Do you think it's that he was afraid of fucking up Triple H?
I don't know what it was.
Because Reigns can work a physical match, which is what I was really expecting. Like, I thought it would look much more brutal.
Mm-hmm. Well, the first thing that threw me off, even from the get-go, was Roman Reigns' entrance. Triple H had this phenomenal entrance
and
that
Roman
I just
had
ate.
Nothing.
I ate it up. I loved it. Roman walks out, boom, and then, like, fucking AT&T starts fireworks going off and shit, and you're
so
like,
the
this
was title match.
This was like some cheap fucking effects we could do on our green screen here.
Sasha Banks had a much better entrance than Roman.
Yeah.
But Snoop, how did we miss talking about Snoop? Let's put a pause on the main event from Hell.
Okay.
And talk about how awesome it was that Snoop, like, rapped at the beginning of Sasha's song.
Yeah.
And how weird it was that the chick that was with him seemed to be off pitch with everything she was singing.
That was just weird. And I forgot about that, honestly, when you mentioned. That was just weird. But yeah, Snoop didn't even get a freaking big. Him and Shaq were just kind of pushed to the back burner. Like, hey, here's these guys.
Yeah, but everyone reacted positively to Snoop. Like, every time he's involved in anything, he's like the most beloved celebrity they've led in the universe.
He can just show up anywhere, and everybody's like, thank God Snoop's here.
They were even cheering when he was rapping.
Yeah.
They're great.
All right,
back to the
shit main event.
I like the happy place.
No, but this match from the get go was just, and you knew it was gonna be long as shit too.
How long was it?
I think it was something like 35, 40 minutes or something.
Was it really?
Yeah, I think it was long.
It felt like the same 5 minutes over and over. I thought it had to be shorter because I couldn't remember anything except the same like
That's
5 minutes.
Problem. I don't remember shit from the match, and I had to watch it twice.
Maybe it was the fact that we were so tired by that point.
Well, you know the fans were fucking tired. They were in the stadium at that point for over 6 hours. So how are you going to keep any steam anyways?
Maybe next year they should break it up into like, I don't know, maybe have a smaller Mania going on somewhere else.
Yeah, something like that.
So the live crowd stays hot? I don't know.
I don't know either, but that match.
Give London, like the small Mania. Send all the foreign wrestlers there, and then you don't have to treat them like heels because America.
The League of Nations.
They'll be like the greatest baby faces in Britain.
No, they won't. They got rid of
one. Oh. Wade Barrett will be the best ever motherfucker in history then.
You know what?
We have his being a bit Mania match planned already.
I think him being thrown out is good. But anyways, the main event for Mania was
we're back to this pile of shit.
Yes.
Let's skip to the thumbs down.
I remember more about Sid and Hogan than I do about this. Yeah,
I have fonder memories of Sid versus Hogan.
And then,
as a child at least, I was floored by Warrior coming back.
And at the end of the match, it's just like, okay, Reigns wins, whatever. Nobody
gives a shit. It was very mechanical, right?
Yeah. People were just walking out at that point, like, man, fuck this. There were definitely boos and stuff. And then the WWE on this point is like, let's add in fucking crowd cheers to our audio. Like, it just sounds like the weirdest mix of bullshit.
No. The really easiest thing I think they could have done to save that main event, and I've said it since they fucked up the opportunity to do it, would have been to add Dean and Brock to that match. And just give that match 50 minutes, let some people take some rest while some other people work the frenzy pace, and the psychology points where you need. But I think even Reigns' win would have gone over so much stronger. I just needed so much that wasn't there.
Yeah, I think Reigns is just going to have to realize that he's not been worked very well into a face role, and he just needs to be a heel at this point. Or he's not even an anti-hero, because nobody's going to cheer him. Like, Stone Cold would come out, people would cheer him. People booed him, and he's supposed to be a good guy.
I think the big mistake for Reigns was when they started giving him so much promo time before he was ready. I think he should just not been near a mic, maybe.
He needs somebody like
right around now. Oh man, would he blossom with Paul Heyman?
Right? My client!
Roman Reigns!
Yeah. He needs somebody that could talk for him, and maybe people would like him, because Brock's supposed to be a heel, but people love Brock to death, because Paul. And honestly,
also because Brock is a super beast.
Yes, Brock is a super beast. And he's been fun to watch forever.
Yeah.
I would have liked to see Kurt Angle come back at this point.
Man, wouldn't that be neat?
All of a sudden it's like, and this match has been changed to a triple threat for the and all of a sudden Kurt Angle, you hear dur, 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 dur. People would have lost their shit.
I really would kind of like to have seen him come back during Rusev's prime to feud with Rusev, and maybe if put Rusev over would have been maybe the coolest thing. They dropped the ball so much on Rusev. He was worth so much money the way they had booked him.
Yeah.
And then they took all the air out of that balloon almost all.
Mm-hmm.
What a terrible decision.
We're still on the main event. And it's so bad we can't even talk about it.
I don't even want to talk about it.
All right.
Well, let's discuss something worth talking about since we already gave that a thumbs down. Favorite Mania match of all time.
Favorite Mania match of all time.
Yeah.
For me, it was probably, it might have been that HBK freaking Razor Ramon ladder match. I remember watching it as, you know, I don't even remember how old I was, but I remember watching it and just wanting to be, I'm like, I want to be Shawn Michaels when I grow up. this is just ridiculous. And then he comes off that ladder. It's just like the full spin. And you're like, oh, oh. And of course, we were watching at my buddy's house because he had the unscrambler card for the cable box. You know, see, my parents would never bought that shit back then. So this is bad because I work for a satellite company now too. But yeah, that was probably my favorite Mania match. I also enjoyed the Austin Bret Hart match. Mm-hmm. It's another one. It really was one that just solidified for me that I loved wrestling. Mm-hmm. You know this. Hogan Rock was another match I really enjoyed. Because I would say I've enjoyed the Rock Austin matches, mm-hmm. but there were quite a few of them at Mania over the years. Probably the Austin Rock one was one of my favorites.
I really loved the first time Triple H and The Undertaker wrestled.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that being the most into a wrestling match I was as an adult for a long time. Because I was really wondering, is Triple H going to win this? And then they just let them go nuts and ignored like the countout rules and the fact that there was... They treated it like no disqualification match without the stipulation. I'm like, this is insane. I'm heavily invested in seeing where the fuck this is going, and I can't believe this match isn't over. Like, they had like 5 minutes outside of the ring with the countout factor fully in effect. But it was an awesome match. After that, maybe Shawn Michaels' angle is really high up there. But if you're going to ask Childhood Steve what his favorite match is, Childhood Steve would say every time, without a doubt, Hogan Warrior. I don't even know that I really think either of this man is not insane. Not, like, looking at like the people they really, really were.
Mm-hmm.
But Child and Steve do not give two shits like what was going on with either of them. Lord knows I'm a trainer myself. But man, that was the main event of baby faces versus baby faces.
Oh yeah, I got you.
Like, gosh, what the heck holds up to that? The only thing that I think could have held up modern day wise to that is Sting Taker, and we'll never see that now.
We'll never see that. The one modern day match, I would say, you know, in my adulthood, I really, you know, loved and enjoyed was WrestleMania 30 when Daniel Bryan won the belt.
That was huge.
Because Orton Batista, it was just this moment of like, it was the payoff for me.
And what you said about, it's one of those things that we talked about. It's the covenant that you feel that the company owes you. And the fans were dicks about it that year.
And they, it's
like the fans as a whole really forced them into such a corner.
Well, not only that, CM Punk also left. And it's like, well, now what are we going to do? Because I think CM Punk would have had a big WrestleMania that year. And it's like, who are we going to go to? Well, go to the guy you keep screwing over.
Well, it wasn't even... they were really just left with the option.
Yeah.
Because the fans weren't letting their main event go as planned at all. It was just going to be the most ignored, hated, universally, like... Because
Batista comes back and
disappointing.
Rumble and...
It would basically be Roman versus Triple H this year. Like, you can only not listen to your fans so much going into that big show.
Yeah, and that's 30. It's got to be good. Like, 32, okay, they're going to get away with this. It's going to be literally probably seen as one of the lower WrestleManias in terms of how good it was. But
it feels like
it's a growth WrestleMania to me. Because there was a lot of good, I think, that came out of that.
Yeah.
And now with Raw, it seems like we're actually... It seems like we finally transitioned from the Attitude Era to the Cena Era. Because I'm going to call it the Cena Era because it was kind of bland.
The PG Era.
And it was, yeah, the PG Era, basically. And now we're getting into... an actual a pure era of wrestling, and it just feels like it's finally happening. It's like all these other guys have finally transitioned out.
I almost want to call it the Honor Era because almost everything they're picking up is
based on Ring of Honor.
Ring of Honor and Ring of Honor's influence, I guess, to a lesser degree, being the Impact Era, but in another company too.
Yeah, we are. I never thought of that.
Bobby Roode showed up at the... I want to talk way more about NXT and like things I like about him. Fuck the main event.
Bobby Roode cracks me up.
But I am excited to see Bobby Roode possibly win.
Well, who else showed up? Oh, God. Who showed up on Raw? God.
Apollo Crews debuted.
Yes, yes. But not him. The rap dude. Oh, God. What's his name? I just had it. It was on the tip of my tongue.
The rap dude?
Yeah, the dude who raps. He has the other guy with him, something in Cass.
Oh, Enzo and Cass.
Enzo and Cass, yeah. See, I've been like not even watching NXT or nothing. They came out there and I was
love
like
Enzo Spill.
I was like marking out and I'm like, how did I not even know about these guys? Because all
you
I've been doing
makes
is
me sad. The only thing that makes me sad about their debut.
What?
Is she just getting left out in NXT without?
I don't know because I didn't even I had seen them like a couple of times in NXT and never really paid much attention because I was always like, you know, because Samoa Joe's never going to get to the main roster. I've accepted at this point.
Yeah, I believe he will.
I don't know.
I think it's more about not depleting NXT before they have enough people there to take the places of the people that they mm-hmm. can bring up. They don't have anyone down there quite like Joe or quite like Finn yet. They want to
keep
really established star there and that really hot young guy down there long enough to make the next one.
But I totally missed over that tag team. I just never noticed. And then all of a sudden they show up on Raw and I'm like,
oh, they're
who the fuck are these guys? They're awesome. Like instantly I'm like,
you missed them? Oh dude, they're great. I've been loving on those guys for quite a while.
Yeah, see when I was watching NXT, I'd go to like certain matches and stuff and just go through it. I was not keeping up with it because I just don't have a lot of time right now. So all I can literally catch is my DVR Raws right now and I can skip through what I don't like, I don't give a fuck about, move on from there. But Raw's been good the last like 3 weeks, so I sit down and watch them, skip through the commercials, I'm good. I totally had missed them somehow in the last year. So, and I had been paying more attention, mind you, to you know, New Japan right now, and I've been watching a lot of Lucha Underground and all. So
we should do a show again sometime. Did you do a show yet for the Takeover?
No, I did not.
We should do a show.
I did not watch
sometime.
The Takeover.
Oh man, watch it this week. Then we'll do a show about that.
Okay, that's fine. All right, so I guess we're gonna go because we're at an hour.
Way cooler than WrestleMania.
Was it? We're at an hour right now, so.
Oh, that's good timing.
That's good timing.
Good timing. Fuck the main event.
Fuck the main event.
Officially.
Yeah, fuck the main event.
Yeah.
Best match of the night, though.
Women's.
You know what? I'm going to say it was a women's match, too.
Yeah, hands down.
I'm going to say.
Should have been the closing match.
It was. It had everything.
Everything was perfect.
Yeah, it was probably the best match. Followed up by probably AJ and Jericho.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I did not give that one a grain of salt going into it. I really love that match.
It's great.
But yeah, the women's match was definitely probably the best showcase on there.
So if you haven't watched WrestleMania, just skip to the women's match, the IC match.
Mm.
Maybe watch the tag title match, Ryback Kalisto, and the tag match.
Yeah.
Battle Royals, they're okay too.
Yeah.
It's okay.
It's all good. Except for
yeah, I
the main event.
I'm gonna pretend the women's match was the main event. We're gonna talk about the show from now. I'm just gonna call it the main event.
We should record it to a VHS, like old school, print out a label, and resequence it, and be like, "This is how it should have went." And then on the dark undercard,
and then just like dub over like some clothing stuff.
Yeah, and add our own boost.
We have a new champion. We'll see you tomorrow on Raw.
Ladies and gentlemen, that did not happen. That was all fake. look at Triple H. He is not the champion. Not the champion. All right, well, we're going to get out of here, I think.
Later, guys.
Have we touched everything?
I'm sure we have.
Are you sure? Are you sure we have, or are you sure we haven't?
I'm pretty sure we have.
All right.
I can't think of what we haven't.
No, I guess we're getting out here, guys.
We ran a little long, kind of like WrestleMania.
Oh.
One match too long they ran.
One match too long they ran.
Could they have closed with the Battle Royal?
They could have closed with the Battle Royal.
I would have been happier.
I would have been happier, too. Thanks for watching the longest Retro Army podcast.
Yeah! We broke records, too!
We broke records!
Yeah!
Thanks for watching. I'm Kevin Morris. This is my guest, Stephen Hensley.
Boom.
And we're probably going to talk more on wrestling.
Yeah!
Check it out on Indy Earth. You can find us on YouTube or you can go to the Indy Earth website, www.indyearth.com. Also, check out my other show, Let's Play Flash Games, which is ridiculous.
You're playing Flash Games.
Oh my gosh, it's terrible. And y'all have a good night. We'll see you next week. Or I'll see you next week with somebody.
This guy.
Face.
Come here.